The Power of the Dog is a new movie by Jane Campion, based on the 1967 Thomas Savage novel of the same name. It is a very international production. Campion shot this in her home country, New Zealand, in 2020, but the story takes place in 1920s Montana. The relatively small cast of American characters are played by English, Australian, American, and New Zealand actors. The Burbank Ranch is run by brothers Phil and George. Benedict Cumberbatch plays Phil, a man seemingly well-suited to the cowboy life. Like the leathers he produces, he's tough, lean, and tanned. Phil is clever, aggressive, charming, but mean, and seems at least a little dangerous. George, played by Jesse Plemons, is his opposite. Quiet, soft, sad. The structure of their home life and the brothers' relationship is altered when George suddenly falls for and marries Rose, Kirsten Dunst. An inn owner who matches George's sadness and gentleness, but has an energy he does not. An energy both positive and negative, as it seems to turn inwards and develop into anxiety and alcoholism. Cody Smith McPhee plays Rose's son, Peter, whose delicate frame and delicate interests seem, at first, completely out of place as he and his mother move into this Montana ranch. The plot thereafter involves complex, shifting relationships, interests, and power dynamics. Most importantly, between Phil, Rose, and Peter. Phil seems to resent Rose, seeing her as a threat to his business, his brother, or at least to his control over those two things, and to his way of life. He takes this anger out on Rose and Peter, bullying and taunting each in different ways. At their first meeting, Phil mocks Peter's lisp and effeminacy and burns Peter's carefully crafted roses. When they move into the ranch, Phil begins gaslighting, intimidating, and fanning the flames of Peter's mother's already present insecurities. So burning and leaving to soak in alcohol another Rose. Peter, curious, awkward, and quiet, discovers Phil's hideaway and signs of Phil's having had a romantic relationship with his mentor, now deceased, known as Bronco Henry. Phil chases him off, seemingly enraged, but from then on, Phil and Peter's relationship is changed. Phil offers a hand of friendship and begins to teach Peter how to be a ranchman, as Bronco Henry did for him. A sense of tension, if not dread, persists though. Campion's direction and the cast's subtle performances mean there's always doubt and anxiety in the air. Peter is still dealing with the death of his father, knows he doesn't fit in here, sees his mother becoming increasingly unhappy, and sees her self-medicating with increasing amounts of whiskey. For this, he blames Phil's menacing presence. And like the budding surgeon he is, Peter begins to clinically, coldly plan how he might excise this malignancy in his new home. Peter and Phil, though, continue to grow closer, with hints even of sexual tension from both sides. Phil is being kind, but after so much evidence of nastiness, we don't trust it. Peter loosens up and begins to present even as seductive with Phil, sharing a cigarette and playing the role of young Phil to Phil's now Bronco Henry. But Peter's behaviour too, we learn, is almost certainly a performance, part of the plan. Though, again, a lot of this is beneath the surface. And in fact, on first watching, I didn't see where the plot was going at all and didn't really even fully register Peter's questions about calves, deaths, Phil's wound, etc. When Peter plays tennis with Rose, Lola, Thomas and Mackenzie, offers to umpire, calling out the score. But Peter says, no, no need to narrate, I'll just remember. I feel like this could be the tagline for the film in terms of its themes and its style. You know, the most important things are not spoken, but they are remembered. And the key plot elements here are not highlighted, nor is there any narration to guide us. We're left in the dark to discover what we can about these beguiling characters, and if we don't remember the details, keep score, well enough ourselves, we might be surprised by their actions. One review I read, I can't find now who it was, called The Power of the Dog, a sympathetic view of toxic masculinity. It's hard not to feel some sympathy for Phil, ultimately, nasty though he is. Clever and energetic, but constantly needing to display a brutish dominance over what he deems feminine in Peter, and the jealousy, contempt he has for Rose. It would be easy to interpret Phil's displays of dominant masculinity as just an act covering over his repressed homosexuality. I think it's more than that, though. Bronco Henry was also a strong rancher, from all reports, of traditional masculinity. So for Phil, love, loss, passion, a desire for connection are all tied up in the memory of this man who taught them those qualities to him from a young age. So acting out so aggressively and acting out against femininity is perhaps a kind of distorted tribute to his lost lover and an attempt to keep his memory and his old-fashioned ways alive. Some of his anger towards Rose and George and towards the world is, I think, out of spite for the love and attention they seem to access so easily. One night at the bar, he stands back staring grimly at the many men and women dancing and flirting. There's no pleasure for him there, though, so he goes home. He calls for his brother there, perhaps for company, but George isn't home because he's spending his first evening with Rose after having comforted her at the inn. Later, when he hears them in bed, Phil's jealousy sends him out from the home, too, to the shed, to memories of a time when he wasn't shut out by or from the world of sexuality, where there he cleans Bronco Henry's saddle. The straight romances all around him further isolate and frustrate Phil. So he turns those frustrations back on them, on the men and women nearest to him. Even his horse, who, when he hears of George's marriage, he beats and calls gender-based misogynistic names. Later, when he's chasing Peter out of his hideaway, he too is screamed at similarly. Recreating the past is a motif throughout. Phil relives fonder memories through his work, his leisure at the Hidden Pond, and through his frequent spoken tributes to Bronco Henry. Peter, too, remembers the past through repeated ritualistic actions. Peter's father was a doctor. We see he passes much of his time reading his father's medical texts and learning surgery. His mother, he tells Phil, was a florist. We see him recreating flowers. For Campion, I think these recreations are, like most things in the film, complex, both positive and negative. They are commemorations and joys for those who remember, but lingering too long or sticking too fast to memories at the expense of finding joy in the present seems to be associated with emotional or psychological instability. In the opening scene, Phil is in a good mood, reminiscing and reminding George that it's 25 years since they first started writing and working together here. But Phil quickly turns sour at George. "You got a sore gut?" when he doesn't accept an offer to go camping again in the mountains, like Bronco Henry taught us, to commemorate the 25 years. "That's a long time," George says. "Not too damn long," Phil replies, as if to say, "It's still close to me, still close enough to remember and respect." George appearing to move on from those memories, including moving on with his life with Rose, is perhaps taken as disrespect by Phil, disrespect to those memories and traditions. The score by Johnny Greenwood adds to all this tension with gentle guitars and pianos that surprise by ramping up or turning suddenly tense and discordant. It is a restrained score which allows the tension to creep up gradually, subtly. The Power of the Dog is not a movie of big moments, but of, on the surface, a steady, matter-of-fact plot with, under the surface, but always sensed, shifting tensions and threats. And the score reflects all of this well. Power of the Dog reminded me a little of Paul Thomas Anderson's great 2007 period drama, There Will Be Blood. That film is set in a similar time period and place, slightly earlier, 20 years earlier, I think, and also centers on a disturbed, domineering man in conflict with a younger man, and is also invigorated by a tense, atmospheric Johnny Greenwood score.
"I'm a family man. I run a family business. This is my son and my partner, H.W. Plainview."
I found The Power of the Dog quite musical, like poetic and lyrical. It is also at times about music and the power of sound. The first time we see Peter, he's cutting up sheet music to make his crafted flowers, and we hear the kind of crisp, slicing sound as he does so. So in this way, even his physical, practical art, crafting paper flowers, is made somehow musical. Diegetic music, music that occurs in the world of the film, such as Phil's banjo playing and Rose's piano practice, reflects characters' moods, vulnerabilities, and even relationships to one another. Phil, always engaged with something, is almost always communicating in some way, whether shouting at animals, holding court telling stories at the inn, or plucking away at his banjo in moments of solitude, expressing himself to the empty night. Even his rope crafting and rawhide tanning seem gestural, like a performance, perhaps for Peter, or as a reminder and a reliving of the connection formed with Bronco Henry through these physical, tactile tasks. George knows Rose can play the piano, he's heard her, and ropes her into performing for guests. She doesn't want to, saying she's out of practice and not very good anyway. Perhaps blinded by his adoration for her and everything she does, or by a desire to show off his new wife, he ignores her protests, and Rose is scheduled to play. She tries to prepare by practicing in the home. She struggles and seems to have her confidence only further diminished, particularly when one day Phil, out of sight and unannounced, begins to echo her keystrokes with banjo plucks. I've never seen a musical accompaniment signify such malice before, as Phil fans the fears she already has about her mediocre musicianship by not just echoing but dominating her performance, by taking over, speeding up and concluding the piece she's trying to practice, all from a very creepy position, out of sight, lurking in the shadows of this old house. Duet becomes duel. She tries to continue and to keep up, but he is more proficient, and the plucking of strings becomes like a bully's laughter, stabbing at her. That she's already embarrassed about her skill and is trying to practice alone in a quiet moment when his banjo appears uninvited makes it feel all the more like a real transgression into a private and vulnerable space. He succeeds in breaking her confidence. When later she is called on to play for their guests, she strikes one note and is herself struck down by stage fright, or by perhaps the sound of banjo strings in her head, and is unable to perform. I often find it effective when filmmakers line up or connect these two things, the music within the world of the film and the music of the film. You'd think it might be too self-reflexive and disengage you like a fourth wall break, but as it's done here, it only adds to the immersion and the richness of the cinematic experience. The best example of this that I know of is one of my absolute favourite movies, the French-Polish film by Krzysztof Kieslowski, Three Colours Blue. In that, a woman, grieving the death of her child and her husband, carries on her husband's project, the composition of a classical piece of music. Grief-ridden, she slowly puts her psyche back together, in tandem with putting together this piece of music, which was commissioned to celebrate post-Cold War European unity. We hear the piece come together, as does the plot of psychological recovery, both in the film and as the musical theme of the film, bit by bit. Music isn't quite that central in The Power of the Dog, nor is it such a through line, but it is similar in its marrying of the diegetic and non-diegetic music. Greenwood's score seems to at times reflect and match Phil's guitar, his whistling, etc. Another example of a film that blurs the lines between diegetic and non-diegetic sound and syncing up action and music in a creative way is the opening sequence of Edgar Wright's Baby Driver. As well as characters' relationships to music, other sensory preferences and sensory-seeking behaviours appear in this film. They're minor, but they also seem important to understanding these characters. These moments also add to the overall psychic landscape of the film, to the feel of this world as real, tactile, and impactful on its characters. For example, Peter seems to soothe or perhaps distract or regain control of himself by running a fingernail across the teeth of a comb, or by playing with a hula hoop. Phil seems most at peace when caressing his rawhides or Bronco Henry's old saddle or when pulling tight on his rope, immersed in the tactile experience as he braids it. Sensory aversions or triggers are also highlighted. Rose shudders at the sound of Peter's comb, remarking that it's like nails on a chalkboard for her. In this context, in a film world of heightened sensory awareness, the piano practice scene then is made all the more intense. We wonder also if, for Rose, alcohol is in part an attempt to self-soothe by drowning out these unwanted environmental noises. Phil refuses to bathe at home, another kind of sensory rejection. George likes to, sensory preference. But in his hideaway, Phil rubs mud over his naked body and swims in the pond. We can guess this was a space and these were activities Phil shared with Bronco Henry and engages in now partly to commemorate or replicate those lost sensual romantic experiences. The depiction of his work with the rope and the hides often shot close and lingered on by the camera, presents these two as almost sensual rituals for Phil. Peter's flower making too is similar, shot with an intimate closeness, as if this too is a vital personal practice for him. Peter explains that his mother was a florist, so for him too, this practice is connected to a memory of work carried out by and shared with a loved one. The film's two central characters, Phil and Peter, are troubled, complex individuals. As we noted, it is tempting to interpret Phil's behavior simply as toxic masculinity born out of repressed sexuality and somehow connected misogyny, and to see Peter simply as effeminate, shy, or even psychopathic. There is something to those interpretations, but they miss the complexity of these two characters, I think. The film as a whole dances between opposing elements in its characters and challenges assumptions such as surface versus substance, presentation versus authentic self, performance versus hiding or passivity, strength versus weakness. Phil and Peter play out the tensions between these opposites with each other, but also internally, individually. Phil presents as so tough and sharp, but hides a vulnerable, sensual, sad inner life of loss and repression. Peter presents as so gentle and awkward, but is revealed to have a steely, stoic bravery and a cold determination. Phil's rough, loud masculinity and physical strength is placed in contrast to Peter's version of strength. Physically, they are opposites. Phil is older, strong, tanned, and almost constantly dirt-covered. Peter is young, pale, thin, and delicate. Internally, though, they also each possess a combination of opposing forces, which makes them difficult to pin down to character or personality types. Phil shouts and cowboys and whips, but then hides himself and his true desires away. Peter is effeminate, quiet, carries on his mother's interest in flowers, but is in some ways more comfortable in his own skin. For example, taking the bullying words shouted by the ranchers in his stride and solves his problems cleanly, directly, stoically. Whether that problem is an injured rabbit needing to be put out of its misery or a person who represents a threat to his mother's wellness. He has a strength in the way he deals with these things. I feel like I don't fully understand a couple of elements of the plot of this film, but I quite like that. Phil's initial offer to make Peter a rope, this scene coming on the back of one in which Phil furiously chases Peter out of his private hideaway, where Peter had discovered, though probably unbeknownst to Phil, literature that reveals Phil's sexuality and suggests a romantic relationship with Bronco Henry. And in the context of Phil's father having hanged himself by rope, this is known to Phil, we think. This offer of a custom-made rope for Peter seems like a threat, but maybe not. Maybe it is a real attempt to befriend Peter, as Peter's behavior throughout the remainder of the film does suggest. Tell me in the comments if you have a view on this or if I've missed something. Was Phil threatening or even planning to kill Peter with that rope? Or did Peter suspect this and it was therefore further motivation, justification for his ultimate actions? Or did he just want to make a rope with him and want to be friends? Tension is generated in The Power of the Dog by uncertainties such as this. Most of these characters are hiding their true motives and feelings. Some seem to be acting. Is Phil's alpha male bravado real or an attempt to mask another part of himself? Is his sudden kindness to Peter real, as we say, or a trap? Or perhaps something in between, perhaps an expression of desire to share, as he did with Bronco Henry, the sensual practice of braiding, pulling, tightening their ropes together. Peter too is inscrutable. His calm, gentle demeanor belies the dark plans he's concocting. I really liked the scene, which leads up to the olive rope branch offering moment, where we watch patiently Peter's gangly, newly adult body walking through a gaggle of real men, shouting Nancy and worse at his awkward gait and rustling new jeans. It's such a painfully long walk, like a catwalk back and forth. At first, in early scenes, we see him upset, by Phil's meanness at least. But here, and often, Peter seems stoic, unaffected by the rancher's judgments and unconcerned with their requirements for being a real man. He later tells Phil his father thought him too brave, or too strong, I think it was. Perhaps a reference to this ability to be himself in the face of taunting opposition, or perhaps a euphemism for him being too cold, psychopathic even, a concern that develops as we witness him calmly practice his surgery on rabbits and put another injured rabbit out of its misery, skin a rotten calf's corpse without emotion. Watching this also made me think of another serious movie I watched recently, Ridley Scott's The Last Duel. Both films have traditional, familiar, genre-bound opening acts, which seem to be leading to one sort of film, but then instead shift to a darker place. They're both violent, sexual, psychological. They could therefore both be described as postmodern reworkings of dusty old genres with an application of 21st century insights into gender and sexuality politics. I mean, they're very different in some ways too. They each handle very different issues differently, but both attempt to reckon with important concerns around gender, sex, and violence. Both take a very familiar genre in The Last Duel, that's the historical war drama. Here in The Power of the Dog, it's the Western, and approach it from a different perspective, with a contemporary awareness of the relevant sexual, criminal, gender, and political issues. But I found Scott's approach crude and simple. I didn't like The Last Duel. It didn't seem interested in complexities or provoking thought, but simply in provoking emotion and dragging us through the evidence for a thought any reasonable spectator in the crowd already held. Like he was making his strongest case to the idiot or the misogynist in the crowd. By contrast, I found Campion's approach here to be bold, complex, and nuanced, encouraging further discussion and analysis by an audience she's treating as smart enough to be interested in ambiguity and complexity. All right, I'll try to wrap up. I realize I haven't talked about the performances at all. As good as they all are, this is really Cumberbatch's movie, as well as Jane Campion's, of course. The modern English gentleman is so good as Phil, a nasty, complicated 1920s American rancher. I've watched a few serious new movies lately. The Power of the Dog was my favorite of them by a fair margin.